And Lord, we just thank you for everybody who's on the window pane tonight. Tonight, Bible study, and whoever is sharing the word, Lord, we ask you to send the word, your word that pierced our hearts and souls of our bodies, Lord, that we won't forget the word that we hear tonight, Lord, but we just won't be a hearer of it, but a doer. And Lord, we bless the apostles and the pastors in the name of Jesus, and bless the person who's bringing the word in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All right. Hi, Denise. We're just going to do a little worship and we're going to get in the word, okay? All the spirit of God is moving on us. Worship. Can y'all hear it okay?
Somebody just wave those hands.
Thank you, Jesus.
We just honor your presence tonight, Holy Spirit.
Yes.
That's all we really want, Lord, is just to be where you are. Just to be in your presence.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Praise is who I am. I will praise him while I can.
Thank you.
Somebody lift your voice and say, praise is what I do. Even when I'm going through, see, I've learned to worship. Ooh, see, I'm gonna let the devil know tonight. No, my circumstance. I will not be depressed. It doesn't even stand a chance.
Baba.
College of Pennsylvania.
Amen. Amen. Whew. Thank you guys so much for that worship. I needed that. Amen. 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 All right. Well, We have Deacon Leonard today. God's going to use him in a mighty way to be able to share a word that he laid on his heart for us today. So I thank and praise God for that. Oh, he's on mute. Sorry. Okay. Deacon, say you there.
Yeah, my people. Yeah. Hello, everybody.
Amen.
Yes, you do. All right. Well, let's get started. I ain't gonna be very long. I just wanted, you got the video? The monster, you got a video?
Okay. Yes.
That video will tell it all. The title tonight is, well, that's not where we're gonna go though. The title, I was watching a movie, and the lady said she was talking to her father. We ain't gonna play the video yet.
Okay.
Don't let that be the ending.
Okay.
She said she was talking to her stepfather. She was talking about a church without a body. And I seen somebody posted today, you know, God is good. Let me just give God the glory first and foremost. You know, God, we praise you and we thank you for giving us vision to see things the way you want us to see them when we repent and submit. Somebody posted earlier today, people going into church. And as they went in, they was actually falling out underneath the church. And the statement was, church people are dying spiritually. Meaning that they're going into the churches, but they're not submitting to the word. They're not allowing the Holy Spirit to have his way. And I think at one point in time, we might have been there, just going to church. It just reminded me of certain things. So when I listened, when I seen it, it just, so many things. I might be in 100 different places, but I think at the end, everybody will kind of sum it up, hopefully, anyway. I wanted to go to a couple of scriptures, and I hope you spoke about it when you was preaching the other day. And I'm missing the Matthew 13. And I'm not going to read the scripture. It was talking about the sowers. How some fell on rocky grounds and, you know, just couldn't get it. You know, they just let everything at the feet. So if we all read Matthew 13, we kind of understand the different sowers. So a church without a body. I remember Dad speaking to us, and he was speaking to me one day, and I think he had got emotion because, you know, we watched the church grow, then we watched it decrease. And we conversated on it, and people just didn't want to get it. You know, a lot of us, you know, in the natural, we would say fake people, you know, the streets, you know. We didn't want them type of people around us when we was living in the world. So when you start allowing God to have his way, you start to see God, when you submit to God. A lot of us, I just feel this covenant that we in, you know, I'm blessed and I'm thankful and I give a glory to God because if I don't want to be nowhere else.
Exactly. Amen.
And I, you know, and believe me, I don't want to be nowhere else. You know, and I can't say I do everything right. But one thing for sure, God got me in the right place. Amen. You know, this week I moved from we had to bid on a different stockpile. So the last stockpile I bid it for, that was the last one I chose to get 11 places to go. And they gave me number 11. Amen. I said, really? And it's out in the boonies. It's like a 45-minute drive from my house. The last stop, pal, I was actually six, seven minutes away from the house. This one is actually 45 minutes. And it's in the middle of no man's land. Ain't nothing around it but farmland. You don't see nothing, no stores, nothing. And Monday was my first day there. And when I got in there, it's only 8 to a stop, pal. So I'm number 8. So when I got in there, everybody got on Trump hats. When I rolled down there, all you see was Confederate flags. But I prayed something last week. I said, God, let me see it the way you see it. Because, you know, being that I had to go to stop how little things that was said to me. But one of my friends said to me, he said, God got you in the right place for the right reasons. And I've been down here 3 days. And all I would see was all these signs. But let me tell you how good God is coming out of there today, because when I go in there, it's pitch dark, so you really don't see nothing. But as I was leaving today, I seen little signs that says, Jesus love you. And I was telling moms when I talked to her earlier to get the video, how Jesus, how big, you got to realize his name was the smallest thing sitting out there under them Trumps and them Confederate flag, but it was the biggest name. You got to realize, you got to hear what I'm saying. When I seen it, you know what the Holy Spirit told me? He told me the same thing somebody thought for me. He said, what if they don't know Jesus?
Right.
See, but the prayer was, let me see it the way you see it, God. Mm-hmm. So coming out of these last 3 days, and I can honestly say, them guys treated me better than the stop pal I was at with people that said they was Christians, that they believed in God. But it's not the people. See, God had to let me see it from a different place. You got to understand, I might have been in church. I might have had people praying on me, but I didn't have no repentance. I didn't have no submission. You know, this was, so everything that I'm saying, it just, I didn't want to study. I didn't want to sit there and just put things together. I just asked God, let me see it the way you see it. And when I left out of that stop pal today, and when I say I try to keep a full tank of gas and I don't make no stops because I know where I'm at. But I know I'm covered by the blood of Jesus at the same time, but I ain't a fool either.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, as I came out of now, I've been just the third day. I ain't never seen these signs. So God was, this Holy Spirit just telling me, well, what if they don't know? You got to understand certain things, hatred and things of that nature. Those are things that are inbred in us.
Right.
Just like, you know, us growing up in the ghettos, you know, we seen junkies and pimps. We didn't know. It wasn't too many people yelling Jesus Christ and teaching us and taking us. You know, you know, a lot of people just wasn't doing the right thing because people didn't want to repent. People didn't want to submit.
Right.
So today was just a blessing. When I, just them little signs, man, them signs, it just seemed like them signs was, huge.
Right.
And then the next thing that just don't, the Spirit just said, what if they don't know? You got to realize we all fighting for a certain reason. But how many of us is out here fighting for Christ?
That's good.
Amen. I felt like I was drifting for weeks, man. I forgot it was Fourth Sunday. You know, and I got upset. You know, and Dad had to talk to me. You know, maybe I felt, you know, today I felt maybe things happened for, you know, I'm hoping that it happened, that certain things happened that I wasn't submitting in the flesh. Because you can submit in the flesh. You could be doing the devil's work and not realize, you know. So little things that just been happening to me over the week, just different doors just been opening up for me. It's not materialistic doors. Like I said, when God deal with you and he places spirit on you, you know, you get to a different place.
Right.
just get to a different place in life. So I just wanted to say that, and I just wanted to play that video because I think when you, this video just, you know, he's a homeless man, and it's going to tell itself. I don't know if anybody else seen the video. I didn't want to gather up a bunch of information and just be talking, you know? And when I came across the video, I'm just going to let the video play. And it speaks volumes. And sometimes I can't always say the things I need that need to be said. But I think this young man really put it out there. And it's a great message. So Oprah, you want to play the video for us?
Yes.
Sorry, I keep on hitting the mute button.
Calling me here, my own desire.
I started from the beginning.
All these things is distracting me from the truth, and it's difficult to give in.
Sorry about this.
But if you can go through it.
Turn the volume up.
Okay, hold on. Sorry.
Just like y'all got a serious intense look. Because he's trying to find his way, he's trying to figure it out.
You hear it?
No, you need to play it loud, Hope.
Okay. Just bear with me 1 second because I got it off a video that mom sent me, so I didn't pull it up on YouTube itself. So I don't know what the volume is because my volume is actually up high, the highest that is going.
Turn the mics up. Everybody turn their volume up there.
All right, let me see if your volume goes up. And if not, maybe I can just go on YouTube itself and pull up the video and then I can adjust the volume myself.
All right, so do that. Pull it up on YouTube because I can't adjust my volume here.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Let me do it.
All right, I'm going to just downsize it. Just bear with me 1 second.
So while she's doing it, I just want to speak about a couple of men in the Bible, you know, that had to repent. And how God, because once you listen to the video, you will understand what I'm saying, you know. And I was reading on 2 Kings 25, as Hezekiah went on, God added him another 15 years. And one of the reasons why he had got sick and everything because he started showing the other kings, the pagan kings, the things that belong to God. And, you know, he wasn't supposed to do that. And God had to deal with him. And I think we get to a point where we have to know when to repent. And, you know, Dad is always telling me repent means to turn away and not go back to. You know, so it was Hezekiah that had to repent, David with Bathsheba, when he took Uriah's wife and he slept with her and he had to repent. And, you know, these are men that repented and didn't go back to their old ways. And I just want to emphasize, I think a lot of times we get into situation and we feel lost about certain things, and or we might have said or did something that was wrong and don't know how to repent. But, you know, God, we love God because God first loved us, you know, and if we understand that, then we know if we come to him in truth and spirit, he'll forgive us. If we truly repenting for our ways and actions. So I just want to emphasize that. It's just little things I just have to inquire for myself. Because I know sometimes I get caught up in situations and I have to go to God. I can't go to Dad. I can't go to Minister Hope. I have to go to God and tell God that I'm sorry and change my ways. And I can honestly say he has. Amen. That's why I said so many doors open up spiritually for me over these last few weeks. And just to see things different, you know, even where I'm at, You know, to be in a place like that, I didn't think it would be comfortable. And I know it's God. You certain things you just can't explain. You just know it's God. You know, where I'm at, I know I'm covered. Because I went down there and asked for God to heal me, to guide me. He made me see things. I'm not just there to just do a job, a physical job. He got me there to do his work. Because them people down there, they don't know. You know, 3 days down there, I could see that a lot of things, you know, if you never seen it or been in it, you know it's been embedded. Just like if you're from the project, you know, the things you did growing up in your neighborhood, it was embedded in us. When you become the same thing that your environment is, it's being embedded. That's all you know. So God got me there for a reason, and I'm thankful. I didn't know how I would feel or react once I got there, but 3 days there, you know, I look at being in the lion's den. You know? And God letting me know.
Okay.
All
right, now let me see how I could do this. Hold on. Sorry, guys. I'm not that... I got a crash course on this real quick. So
me too.
Let me see. Oh, wait. Okay. I think I got it.
Wait, figure it out. To God, my own flesh and my pulling me here, my own desires, my family, my friends, all these things is distracting me from the truth, and it's difficult. Especially when you're young, man. But if you can go through it, you'll come out like, yo, if I can go through the fire. Want to go through the fire. They went to Lotto and go to Jamaica and the Bahamas to do their own selfish thing. They said, you wait till I exalt you. I give you desires of your heart. They got time. They got a cell phone. They want to text message you. Y'all in the same car. You going to text message me right now. Everybody hurry. I don't know where they're going, but when they get there, ooh, they're going to be sorry. The faster you try to get there, their career, their money, and you're going to figure out that, man, it was the journey. It was not the destination. You was in a hurry to get there, to come up, to be this, to be that. And when you get there, you're going to feel discouraged more than you did before you even started to get there. Because it was the journey, the people that you didn't stop to talk to like me at Chicken. The people at the gas station. You was in a hurry to get there, but it was the journey. The more humble you be, then the more you can be fulfilled with the truth. But when you think you got it, you're on your way, then you're going to get less of it because can't nobody talk to you. You can't stop. You're in a hurry. It's a difficult thing, but you got it. I see the intensity. Relate, connect to the people. Say this, it's a man with pushing a basket. This man right here, they grill, you know. Don't look at the outside appearance. I've seen him in action. People pushing a basket. And the bridge. And I was talking to everybody except him. I talked to him. He said, why didn't you talk to me first? He said, don't you ever pass by a man pushing a basket and don't acknowledge him. I never do it in my life. Dude. I talk to the person pushing that basket. How's your day? How you doing? I talk to the homeless people because they said, be careful how you entertain strangers. And most people that came off the street and they got their career together, they won't ever let you know that they've been through it. Right. They try to act brand new. It's a testimony. what she go through, what she go through. It's for us to inspire somebody else. It's for me to pull the wigglers up. It's for you to pull the wigglers up. We don't go through this because of our own suffering. We go through this to give a testimony of how far God has brought me. And it was never about me. It's not about me. Why I'm going through this? He said, back up, man. Who are you going to inspire? Who are you going to tell somebody about the glory and the grace of God if you don't go through it?
Amen.
Get out of yourself. And once I step back, I've been seeing the deep things of God. And so I don't play with it. I don't ask him for a lot. I just say, give me my portion for the day. I don't want a lot of things. Just give me enough so I can deal with. He said, I give you, but fulfill your mind greater than you can ever ask. I know what you desire. I know what you need. But Lord, give me my portion where I can be grateful.
Amen.
Where I can be thankful. They are thankful. They are holy. They are grateful. They got a job. They don't want a job. They got 40 hours. You can't work on Saturdays. You can't work on Sundays. Now you got 3 days. You stay always complaining and griping and murmuring. Stop it. He said, be grateful with the little things. And wait, and I'll put you there. But he's going to put us in a place where they appreciate me in the job. Don't nobody take time to let them know why they're doing things they're doing. If that's the whole purpose of life, let them know what they're doing wrong if you see it. I didn't always knew I was doing wrong. What about when they showed me long suffering? What about when they forgave me, but I can't forgive him? He made a promise. I made a promise. I didn't fulfill it. They didn't go off on me. Well, I got to go off on him because he didn't fulfill his commitment. That's wrong. You got to teach. They don't know. The only God they know is through you, through your experience. They don't know about church because you can't go to church because it's a business. And all the church people, it's a clique, it's a club. And they forgot about God. It's a business. Look here. It's just the world. Ain't nobody being bold and talking about God because don't pray in school. Take the prayer out of school. All it's the world. We're getting in a time where God is not popular no more. If you talk about it, I don't believe in Jesus. I don't believe in God. I believe in this. I don't care what you believe in. Let my spirit speak for me.
Come on.
Let my action. But it was a time when I was just a hearer and not a doer. But you got to balance out. You got to go through the fire in order to be a doer too. You're going to be a hearer, then you're going to be a doer. But don't let people throw you off your journey. You can't be nothing. It's between your relationship with God. They can't understand you all the time because you're trying to figure out your way. I'm trying to figure out my way. I can't prove nothing to them all the time. I don't need them to figure me out. All I got to do is just be patient and do what was in my ability, my boundary. I don't need to outstep my boundary. I ain't got to prove nothing to you. You didn't feel me? No, you can't go feel me. I can't put the expectation on you. I don't always feel me, understand me. So that's wrong. Be humble.
Yeah.
Acknowledge him in all your ways. When I do wrong, I said something wrong to offend you, forgive me. I got to say it right away, get it over with. If I offend somebody at work, look, if they persecute me, look at God trying to strengthen me to show them who I serve. I say I believe I'm working with it. Well, teach them. They don't know. They don't know why they're doing that, why they're doing that to me. Let your light shine among men. They might glorify your Father here.
Yes.
It's real, man. I experience it all the time, 24/7. But I asked for it. I wanted to be a preacher when I was 6, but I didn't know the price I had to pay. Much wisdom, much grief, much sorrow. Ain't no other way you don't get it. But if you can just go through the fire, you'll be like gold. When you take the jury to the pawn shop, how do they determine if it's real or fake? Yes. They put the fire upon it. That's how we know if we're real or fake. You don't go through the fire. You don't have disagreement with each other, but it's okay. You don't be friends. But if you have a disagreement, it's just a different agreement. That don't mean you ain't got to see it no more and talk to her or talk to her or whatever. I ain't got nothing to hide. My burdens are heavy, but talk to me. He speaks to me. The weaker I get, the more frustrated I get with my life. And I did this, I did that. Then the more he speaks to me, the more he takes control of me. That's just what he wants you in. Get frustrated. That's why he gonna speak for you. But you gotta, he gotta get you in that point where ain't nowhere else to go but to him. He said, those that I love, I correct them. I chastise them. When you go to jail, they call it Department of Correction, Rehabilitation. But we get mad at the correction. He said, if I didn't love you, I would correct you. He could have took our life. Amen? Amen. He could take the life. But he corrected me. I just thank God for y'all. But this is what Solomon asked. Solomon was the wisest man that lived. He had everything that man could desire. But one thing God said, leave the fire women alone. But he couldn't understand why he had a desire for the fire women. But see, the Lord knew that they were going to turn his heart against him. They were going to make him idol worship and build a God. But he didn't understand it. And I'm going to say this, the preacher, he searched the world out. He said, I want to know the basis behind wisdom and knowledge and understanding and foolishness. See, you can't know wisdom and knowledge, you should be a fool, but we don't want to be foolish. That's the only way you're going to get it. You got to be a fool first. How you going to know a fool when you see a fool? How you going to know foolishness if you haven't been foolish? See, you can't know wisdom and knowledge, you should be a fool, but we don't want to be foolish. That's the only way you're going to get it. You got to be a fool first. How you going to know a fool when you see a fool? How you going to know foolishness if you haven't been foolish? Foolishness is kind of worse and painful. We got a lot of abilities. We can create. We can be inventors, but we're limited. If I understand that I'm limited, then that's when God takes control and gives me the wisdom that I desire. Humility. Be humble. If you understand your purpose, ask God. But ask him in sincerity. What's my purpose, God? Did you ever ask that question? What's my purpose? Why I'm here? What am I meant to do? But sometimes he can't tell us all at once. It might be too much.
Wow. Listen.
All the guys, the rumor report. Guys, with Angela
McGee. It's the rumor report.
The Breakfast Club.
Well, Annalee Chapa was arrested over the weekend. They said he had multiple charges, including burglary, carrying.
That was the end of that.
Possession of Xanax. So that is a update, but this is what we know thus far as this is breaking.
That's sometimes, right. Sometimes that's the young rapper's starter pack, right? Ooh. Some Xanax, guns, right?
You need to shut that one down, bro.
Well, we'll see what happened. All right, now, DJ Envy, you and Gia Casey actually hosted a, I guess it was it like a...
Okay.
I think he said it all. I think the video spoke for itself. So he could drop the mic.
Well, we had a few more minutes, and I do have to say this. I thank you for hearing God on this one, because I've really been struggling with this for the last couple of days. And it's funny that you play this video, because I just really was like, Lord, I'm thankful for everything that you've done for me. And when I think about, like, when I was in the world, you got to explain who you are, and you didn't, I was tired of that. And then, so for me to get into the body of Christ and I got to explain who I am and what God is doing in my life, it kind of hurt my feelings a little bit. because people look at the manifestation in your life, but they don't know all that you went through and all that you had to get here. And if anybody would have just wanted to know why and how, instead of just assuming, just thinking like you're not giving God the glory or whatever the case may be, that's kind of wrong. And that's just what the man said, because God had to remind me. I remember, and I don't know if y'all ever heard this story, but I never like to tell my story. And y'all really probably don't know my whole story, and this is not a time to say it, but when I was in the world, people judge you. And then like when you get into Christ, I thought this was my safe haven, and then people still judge you. And that bothered me more so than anything, because I remember when I was living in the world, I didn't want to give I felt bad giving drug money to church, because that was my safe haven every Sunday. I did everything I did under the sun, Monday through Saturday, Sunday. So I went and got a job. And so I was 100% tithe. I didn't know about no tithes. Then I just wanted to give, I gave the whole check because I just knew it was clean money. And my whole point of saying that, right, when the FBI came at me, they said, the reason why we not giving you life or whatever is because you came from a good family and you had a job. So my tithe of going to church on that Sunday saved my life. So when I give to God, it don't matter what I do, how I do, like God's never gonna let me outgive him. So when I say a blessings of what God is doing in my life, they don't know my story, where I came from. I died to self. Cause then when I knew about that and I was like, man, I'm telling my friends on the street, y'all better flip this money. Cause this is flipping your money, putting it in Jesus' pot, because I'm trying to tell you, he saves you. Cause I ain't walking out of church with a red dot on my forehead. I ain't having nobody set me up. I had peace. So my story about giving and just giving to God and just being there, it's so much bigger. So like people see the manifestation now, but when I came here, I had $30 in my pocket. I was 3 months pregnant and I was homeless. I gave everything up so I can see what this God thing looks like. So as I walk with God, be obedient to God and hear God and use wisdom, like this is before I even came to freedom. He did a lot in my life. I died to self. So when God see this manifestation and people see this manifestation, just because I don't always give God the glory, then people think it's just me. It's not me. I give glory to the people that don't know God, those people on those streets, those homeless people, the ones that talk to and all the above and XYZ. I give my praises there, but I didn't know I really had to justify my praises when you in church. And people get that mixed up. So I thank you so much for sharing that video, because I prayed to God. I said, Lord, if I repent, if I ever felt like I was giving me more credit than you, then you need to check me. And he had to remind me where I came from and how much that I came here and what he's done for me and all the above. Like I figured like if I had all this in the world and didn't have God, and then for me to give all this up to have God, that's the best investment I can possibly have. He says, that's how people are in the streets. You got to go reach them. You got to get them, because they think the same thing, that they don't need God. So everybody's testimony is different. So for that man, and for you to use God, for God to use you today to see this video, it gives me confirmation that God said, I hear your heart, daughter. You keep on doing what you're doing. It's not for the glory of God. It's trying to save souls, because I've been there. I know what that looks like. And so when that man said on fourth Sunday, when we prayed all night prayer and said, you treaded on places that you needed, where God's taking you back to get them and all that, all I thought about is me and you say, we're first to go out in them streets and really do what God called us to do. And not that anybody else can't go, but where those places you go and you got to be equipped and you got to know. They not playing those games, you know what I'm saying? Like this man said, like you... It has to. And so when I always joke around and say, like, Lord, he showed me that ghost. I don't care about cars. Trust me when I tell you, I'm happy with the car I have and whatever. But when you drive up in something like that, it speaks for itself. It says you don't even have to talk much. And so that's why God said, I know I have to bless you with this. So when you drive up, all you can talk about is the Lord and give him the glory. And that's how you get them. So I thank you so much for showing this video, because it just lets me know right where I'm at, regardless of what people think, whatever what people say, or whatever the case may be. God said, you keep on doing my work, because they don't know what you're doing behind the scenes of what God is doing in my life, of how many souls I've saved, how much fruit I have, and all the above, and XYZ. So I just had to say that, and I thank you so much. And I already shared this with Apostle earlier today, because God laid it on my heart. So I'm not saying anything behind nobody's back about anything. That's what I shared. And I thank you so much, because the video just gives me confirmation where God said, you keep on doing what you're doing. I remember I was at a gas station. He had to remind me, if my outfit and all my clothes wasn't at a couple stacks or whatever, I wasn't dressing cute. I ain't feel cute that day. So for me to have these shoes on, and I went and got gas one day, and when God was really stretching me of trying to get closer to him, the girl said, she was attended at the gas station. What size? No, she said, those are some bad shoes, girl. Look at her shoes she got on, this, that, and the third. And then Lord said, give them to her. I walked away with a whole bad outfit about to go somewhere with some flip-flops on. So like my walk and the stuff, it don't matter to me. But that girl, and I had to give a witness to her. She said, you gonna give me, I know how much. It didn't matter, because God blessed me with these. He can bless them with you too. So there's a lot of things like behind the scenes where people don't know, people don't see. I don't think I need to really have to justify anything to anybody, but I see that I do, and it's okay. But God's using us in a mighty way. That's why I love so much about this covenant. And I'm learning on God's word.
Wait a minute.
I'm growing and growing and growing, and let God use me. But people don't know people's story. Like that homeless man, he spoke through God. So regardless of what we look like on the exterior, what God says what's in the inside of us is going to come out. If I love God, I'm going to love God through his people. I'm going to love God and showing, growing, and all the above and X, Y, Z. So I thank you again so much for this video. I didn't know what you were going to play, but it's just let me know right on time for these last 3 days. I've been fasting. I've been praying. It's like, Lord, I never want to perceive that image about me doing anything. I want you to get the glory in everything. Mm-hmm.
For weeks, I just didn't want to, you know, and I have wrote down scripture, but it just, you know, I know what I said. I said, God, let me see it the way you see it. And like I said, I was kind of upset about the move, the whole situation, the stockpile, whatever. And when he do it for you, it's like, you know, I thought I'd be out there giving testimony in my hood. You know what I'm saying? But I realized this week, it won't be in my hood. It's going to be where he wants me to be. And where he has me at, I can actually say because of his presence, and I know it's going to come with issues and stuff like that, but as long as I'm serving him, I already know it's going to be all right. You know what I'm saying? Like, I as long as I'm obedient,
that's it.
You know, I wrote a long time ago, I got on my wall, the first, and I'm just going to say the first word. The first word I put up there was obedience. And I know if I walk in obedience, I'm going to be all right. And that's why I always, you know, I had to emphasize about repentance, because I think when we get to that point where we know we didn't do something right, and we honor God, it's easier to repent and not go back, because repent means not to go back to it. So for those that don't know, that's what it means. It means to repent means not to go back. You know, and some of the first scriptures I read was don't vow to God and don't live it out. That's the, you know, so when I repent, that's what I mean. And I ask God to just let me see it the way he see it. And like I said, on the way home today, he was like, they don't know.
But we do. We do. And when that lady on Friday with all night prayer, she was like, Denise and Hope, I need y'all to say thank you. and just cried on thank you, because that's your breakthrough. And as I was thanking God, God said, you never really thanked me for saving you, because you've been in a lot of situations where you should have been dead. You was appreciative and you were happy that you didn't get life, or you didn't get, you weren't dead, but thank you. And that really broke me to where I'm at right now, of just me being thankful for being alive. So yes, I know I need to do what I do and how I need to do it and all the above. And now I just thank God, because he's just saying, go higher in thanking me and praising me, and go higher in giving to me. And that's what I got. I was like, wow, God. So this video again is so good, because I like
homeless people. I posted that. I had that video, and it just it hit me today, that video. It just, I'm like, yo, God, I need you right now. I need, because you, I don't feel I always express things the way it should be expressed. So that video, and I found, she was like, well, let me look on your page. And she the one that actually found it. Because I was having a hard time trying. I said, the devil's a liar. And I called Mons about 6:30, I think, maybe 6:20. I said, Mom, I'm looking for this video. I can't find this video. She said, I'm going to pay. And she said she found a couple of them. And she posted the one I needed. She said, this the one? I'm like, look at that. I said, yes, it is. And I said, I already knew that video right there was going to explain everything that needed to be explained tonight for us. You know what I'm saying? Because I think, you know, what I'm going to just say that, because with this covenant, it's starting to bring the best out of people.
Absolutely.
And when I say the best, you got to understand, you, God wants you to, I feel like this, God wants you to be real. He wants you to be who you are, because that's the first thing Dad said to me when he asked me to be the deacon. I was upset. and I called him. He said, no, I want you to be who you are. So I thank God for accepting me in my mess.
Absolutely.
Because I was messy. I still am messy. But I don't cover my mess no more. I ask to be clean from the mess.
We learn from
it. And I think the more we as a covenant start understanding that and feeling that, it's nothing but growth. It's nothing but blessings. And like I said, my blessings, it wasn't materialistic. It was letting me see the things I needed to see to open up my heart. Because sometimes, you know, I was going to go into, I had scriptures, I think it was Ephesians 6, when it said put on the whole armor. You know what I'm saying? The whole armor, when you got the whole armor on, you love it from head to toe.
Absolutely.
No matter what the situation is. And, you know, just those statements that you hear, you know, I think Mom's posted it today. People's not going to give you back the same love that you're giving. But I'm realizing it's okay, because my everlasting is not here on earth anyway.
Not at all.
You know, I think, you know, you know, when we were in the flesh, we wanted now. That's what the flesh is. The flesh wanted now. I'm learning about later. When I gotta go before him.
Yes. Amen. I had something in my notes last week, and it really profound, that Dr. Stanley said one time. He says, what matters more than material blessings are the things that he is teaching us in our spirit. Mm. And when you said about being called a deacon, I remember when they said I had to be a pastor and a minister. And trust me, I'm going to be honest. When I stood up there, they thought I was crying because I was happy. But I was like, oh, my gosh, this is what I got to do. And, you know, you got to live up to the standard. I'm not there. I don't want to be there right now. And all the above. But through it all, just being obedient, God has changed me immensely through this. Even just my prayer time, my study time, and just a whole lot of stuff, you know. So even though we don't accept it and don't think we at that level where we think we need to be, we're right where we're at. And I remember I didn't know anything about the Holy Spirit at the time. And it was like 1999 and I gave my life to Christ. I didn't even know. I thought it was a whole poltergeist thing. I'm sitting in the pews. And next minute I know, I look up and all these people at me and the man's holding my hand. And I was like, why are they looking at me? And I was like, I was kind of a little ghetto on it because I ain't understand what the Holy Spirit, because I ain't know. So the Holy Spirit, now that I know, walk me to the front to give my life to Christ, and then they take you in the back to get your information, all this. And I was like, listen, I made a mistake. This ain't what I want to do right now, because there's so many things that I want to do, and I know it ain't godly, so I ain't even going to play with God like that. I grew up as a little kid in a church, and I know you don't play around with God, so I would be playing around with him, so I ain't ready yet. And she says, it's not when you ready, it's when God has called you to be ready. And at that point, it changed my life. I'm just being real, because I didn't want it, didn't know, not knew about Jesus. Like I said, I done went to college, and those were my college days when I used to catch that bus to go to church, and them people, I felt bad giving money, like it was bad. And I couldn't even understand what they talk about. They stayed in line to pray for an electricity bill. I could not figure that out, that to save my life. I said, electricity bill, what are these people praying for? I'm trying to pray for my life to be like, make sure I ain't getting killed, make sure ain't nothing happening. And they playing, you know, praying, and I didn't understand. But then when he told me to strip myself from everything, trust me, I done prayed for electricity bill, paid for food, I done prayed for all of that. So I've been at that place and know what that looks like, and I still am. Trust me when I tell you. So it's just like God is epitome of balance. When you don't understand, you go through stuff, then you can quite understand. That's why it's not good to judge nobody and say that they should do this or do that, because you don't know where they're at, and they don't know. You just don't know. All you can do is pray for them, give them encouragement, and be that example of what Christ looks like the best way you know how to.
And that homeless man, he really, you know, the first time I heard him, it's not the same as I heard on tonight, because I'm just looking at him like, and him speaking like, and he ain't got a worry in the world. And he basically said that, as long as he got Jesus, you know? Like, he all right. And when that's how I feel.
Thank you, Jesus. Because I came back home, they thought I was, I don't know what they thought. They thought I hit rock bottom, and really I didn't hit rock bottom. I hit rock bottom for Jesus, because I gave everything up for Jesus. So, and I ain't even want to tell them, explain, because I was just like, okay, whatever. Because I was just trying to find myself and trying to find out what that Jesus looked like. But people look at the material stuff. You don't have, even to my dad, you don't have this, you don't have that, you don't have this, this, that, and that. And all I kept on saying, I got Jesus in my heart. And it's funny because they can't see Jesus. You know, and it's funny. So I just wrote out and let them figure it out for themselves. And I didn't have to tell them. But now God's showing them to see, like, okay, I know she knows Jesus now.
Yes. God is good, man. It, right where you at. And that's what I'm learning, you know. Right where I'm at, God just, he's dealing with
all of us. We got to keep on growing in him. Yeah, that's definitely. Why I love this covenant. It's like you... it's just good. You're getting fed a lot of word, and you got to eat it. You're just eating it. And at this point, we should be fat. Yeah. Fat with the fruit.
What you said, I wrote it down too. Faithful, available,
yep.
Teachable, right?
Right, exactly.
I listen sometimes. I ain't gonna say all the time.
You do, but the words that you say, even when you reminded me of what Apostle said a couple weeks ago, it just, like, at first I heard him, but I didn't really hear him. You know what I'm saying? Right. And then so when you said it, I could apply, and I says, okay, now I know what this looks like, Lord. I know what that means. So sometimes you got it. It's just like the Bible. We read a scripture. You can never exhaust the scripture, because one year point in time, you read it one way, and then you in a different step and stage in your life, and you read that same scriptures on a whole different level, but it's the same word. That's why you can never exhaust God's word. It's just
Yeah, you made me understand the struggle and the storm. It's just a form of balance. It's really how you look at it. A form of balance, because if you don't have no balance, you'll get to the point where you feel you don't need God no more. So I understand when the struggle come and the storms come, where I need to be and who I need to call. So I'm growing.
I love that video part where they had a tightrope. tightrope, ain't nobody there to hold you. You riding on that tightrope and you either got to look straight or you about to fall over.
Yeah.
And that was over a mountain. It was a whole, it was so much in that video that it was just so amazing. You know, it was just good. It really blessed me. And I'm just tired of talking about that. Thank y'all so much for just hearing my heart, because it was just right on time. And it just gave me confirmation. God said, keep on doing what you're doing. So I'll leave it open for Denise or Angela. And we just want to pray for Pastor Carolyn, because she's not feeling well. And I want to pray for a family. I have wrote their family down. A little kid, 13 years old, got shot somewhere, I think in York. And I think the family's name is Peoples. And just keep them in prayer, because that was really hard, because one of my line sisters was her student. And that it just really took her out to be. It was a lot. So we just want to keep them in prayer as well. Just the whole gun violence, it's just getting crazy. Like,
me and my wife were just talking about that, you know, just speaking on it, you know. It takes, you know, it takes a village to raise these kids. Yet, you know, we see them, and, you know, one or two people saying it to them is just not enough. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know Pooley, my daughter, wanted me to speak at one of her friend's son got killed. And I said, what you want me to tell the church, that the next killer that's going to kill your son sitting right here? I said, you know, that's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to go in there and do all that dumb stuff, because we sitting them on killers, because y'all don't, you know, all of y'all know each other, but your kids killing one another. Come on, like, really? Like, y'all sit here, y'all too busy doing other stuff, and y'all keep asking for people to save your kids, bury your kid, but you don't even want to tell your kids to get off the street and come in the house.
That's a message right there.
I see that. I mean, all these kids, like, the parents know each other, and your kids act like they're strangers.
I read something today. It was so funny on a booklet. It says, it's who they are and not what they do. So it's like, you got to love the person for who they are and not because of what they do.
You know, any young men, and, you know, and not to put it off, you know, because I could just talk, and I'm going to say, I could talk about my own feeling. Whoever don't like it, just don't like it. You know, I was just telling, you know, my granddaughters, you know, the stuff y'all doing. A lot of these men getting killed over y'all. Everybody's sleeping with everybody. That's one of the main factors why everybody is starting to shoot each other. Your baby mama sleeping with her baby daddy. Come on. Like, and nobody's saying nothing. You know, like my granddaughter just got jumped at Walmart. They said nobody helped her while she was with a baby.
That's horrible. Absolutely.
But you got to understand, the point of the matter is, you and the girl that got beef, y'all was best friends, but y'all slept with each other, baby daddies. Come on, like, come on. You can't hang out with me because I'm not getting beat up and jumped in Walmart. Nada. Can't do it. And nobody's saying nothing. Y'all sitting here acting like it's cool. Y'all, now the parents want to fight each other. Won't you beat your kid? You know, like I had to tell her, what part that y'all find not to be nasty?
Yeah, I just seen on the news when an Asian lady was getting beat, and the man and somebody in the store or the building just shut the door and act like it was okay. That's the world we're living in. So we just got to keep on showing the love of Christ and keep on doing what we got to do and minister to these lost souls.
Yeah.
Facts.
Pretty much. All the time.
And it's not like we don't know what that looks like. We ain't never, I got jumped when I was in seventh grade, but still, it's like just that life, that whole life and all the above and XYZ. We might not can't change the world, but at least we can change the environment that God has allowed us to be in and allow us to have that platform.
Yeah. I believe in God. I guess he got me down here saving these folks, so he can have somebody come up here and save these folks. It's weird how God works sometimes, right? He'll take you out of your environment.
Yes, most definitely.
To do something else, for, you know, and bless where you come from. Because, yeah. Like I said, my blessings is because the doors that's opening up. It's nothing materialistic. It's just the way I'm seeing things, you know? I can't say they see it the way I see it. But he, you know, that's how he got me. I wasn't that comfortable with it. I can't say I'm in it's enjoyable, but I know he asked me. And that's the difference. I, you know, I realized today that he definitely asked me. So,
amen.
Just open up them doors to do your will, Lord, today and tomorrow, and whatever days you have left for me here.
Yeah.
Hi, Angela. You got your frown on. I see you, Niecy. You see how Niecy got a little frown on?
Amen. Well, thank you so much. This was so good. And just know when you're free, you could talk about it. That's the thing about it that I always say. When you deliver with something, you could talk about it.
Amen. I love y'all.
All right.
Well, good to Angela, see y'all.
Angela, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you.
All right. Would you like to close us out in prayer?
Sure. Hold on. Why are you looking like that, Niecy? What's up?
I think she looks frozen.
Is she frozen? That's probably what it is, too. Yeah, she frozen. I was wondering why she had that same face for about 5 minutes.
There she go.
I'm talking smack.
But your face was like this, niece.
Yeah.
Amen. All right, Angela, you ready?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, Lord, I just thank you for this word tonight. I thank you for that video that was presented. I thank you for the testimony today. We can be fed. Thank you for all the doing in our covenant, all the changes. Lord, I know sometimes we don't want to get through that fire to be come out on the other side, to be changed, to get pruned, so we can continue to flourish in our lives, just to bring more people to you, Lord. So I just thank you for all the things you continue to do. The love of Christ will show through us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And Angela, tell Lawrence and your daughter we're praying for.
Always.
Yeah, I don't talk as much to him.
He'll find his way, you know. Like I said, I've been places too, and you know, and I'm thankful today. People been who's out there praying for nothing. Trust me.
I know.
You know. So we praying for him.
I was about to say somebody was praying for us. That's how we get to be rare right now. Yeah, so we got to pray for them. So that's a good thing about it. Well, I didn't even know I had a little ball in here.
I'm praying for you too, Niecy.
All right. Well, we love you guys. Thank you so much for Bible studies, Deacon Leonard. You really heard God, and even just in that territorial places, because I drive through Sillings Grove and see the big Trump signs, and I see them little small signs that just talk about God, and it just like, it helps me to get to my destination, you know, just to know like he got me covered, because he puts you in territories that you don't know, but like at your job where you said that they nice people just as much as they were Christians, and that's a blessing because God's going to use you there, and that's why he put you there. And I'm just excited to hear the testimonies because you just never know what your purpose is. First of all, they probably thinking like, oh my gosh, there's a cool white, a black guy that even is cool. You know what I'm saying? So that's a starter just for you being there. You don't even got to say much because they doing the same, you doing the same job as they are. You know how some places they think, you know how that is. So just let God use you and keep on using you and just keep on, don't lose your witness. That's it.
Amen.
That's all you got to do, because that's how you get the character. That's how they're going to see the God in you. Like that man said, some things is not to be shown. I mean, said, like, you know how you can see better than you can hear? And that's where a lot of people are, where we're in those areas that we're not too sure, and we'll let God use. We don't got to throw the Bible at him. We don't got to have the Jesus t-shirt on. We don't have to have all of that to just represent God. It's our actions. It's our words. It's our things that we do and what we how we react for them to see. It's something about you that's different. And when they come to you and ask you, then that's when it gives you an open door, because God will give you that open door.
Yeah.
You don't got to bust through it and all of that. But, you know, it's just sometimes he puts us in places that are a little uncomfortable for us to really be, for God's light to, you know, shine.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
That could be at a grocery store. It could be at a store somewhere. It could be your neighbor. It could be anywhere.
Something happened to me. I was in Farm Grove. That was the last place I would see.
We got you. We are now that part. We got you. Okay. All you have to do is make a phone call. That's all. So let's hang up there, because we want to stay on this one.
Check it.
He trying to test my walk.
Check,
man, let me see if check every
corn,
that
check light. Every corn wagon coming out of there.
Like, yeah, you can't, not, gas, make sure your gas is full. You keep it moving. Use wisdom, period. Because I know I do.
You better believe it.
Love you guys.
Love you too.
Love you.
Tomorrow, bye-bye. Prayer, power prayer. So get excited.
Love good night, you. Everybody.
Good night.
Deacon Leonard, I'm going to give you a call, so please answer the phone, because I've been trying to call you for like 2 or 3 days now. So
I know I'll be out there. I don't get no service in certain places.
Gotcha.
So I won't get out the truck.